Hello, everyone. My name is Jordan, and welcome to the Fandom Optimists, the show where we love content and we love when it brings us together. This week in fandom, the third episode of Moon Knight arrived on Disney Plus, and I am honored to be joined this week by co-host of the SJW Comic Book Club, Monte. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here.
Also, you actually pronounced my name right. Usually people say Monty. You're like one of the few people who's pronounced it right without me telling them.
I'm glad. I caught y'all's Lucifer episode yesterday. I got to listen to that. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was.
Dear listener, go check out the SJW Comic Book Club. And their Lucifer episode in particular was a lot of fun. I just really enjoyed that one.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for being here. And did you like this newest episode of Disney Plus's Moon Knight?
I did. I have to admit that, so when I watched the first episode, which I only watched because I was going to be on this podcast. So when I watched the first episode, I was like, I don't know if this is for me, but the second episode I enjoyed a lot better, and the third episode I enjoyed a lot more than that. I think it just took me a while to get used to Steven in particular. Mm. Like, at first I found him to be kind of a weird character. Not weird, because I like weird characters, just kind of difficult to relate to, because everything... It just seemed like everything in his life was just so bad. And
I know, I feel so terrible for him all the time.
Yeah. And it's like, and people were mean to him and stuff. And I was like, you know, you shouldn't be mean. I'm not saying you should be mean to him, but also, like, he would be kind of a difficult person to deal with. So I can understand why, like, sometimes people wouldn't want to be around him and stuff, but
yeah,
like
makes
people
sense.
Were like aggressively mean to him in a way that was, I was just kind of like, geez, like, can he have a break? But the third episode, like once it gets into the action and you see him kind of taking a stand on things and mm-hmm. being a little more assertive, he was just a little bit more relatable as a character when he seemed to have a little bit more agency, which is kind of weird considering what happens in the episode, or I think it's the second episode when it happens, but in the third episode he's like trapped in his own mind, but he weirdly has more agency than he did before, I think.
Yeah, he's being a lot more assertive about, you know, I really don't want you to hurt people.
Yeah,
and that's pretty cool to see. I'm really loving Oscar Isaac playing these two wildly different characters, really, in his own mind.
Yeah, he's so brilliant. He's such a versatile actor. Like, even here he's doing it within the same movie, but like his past roles and stuff, he is able to pull off so many different things.
Yeah, I think my favorite acting moment in this episode was when we finally see him switch and we just watch it happen. Where he switches from Mark to Steven, he goes, "All right, you're in," and he just completely changes his whole demeanor. Goes, "Cheers, thanks." And it's like, "Oh wow, he became a different person right there. That was impressive."
Yes, yeah. I also
it's
like
cool when an actor can do that.
Yeah, and in this episode, I think it was around the same part, like when they needed Steven's knowledge of like Egyptology and stuff. It was really good to see him play that character in a way that like other people needed him. Cause before he was just, you know, nobody really, he was more of a hindrance and a burden, and he kind of played the character as a bumbling sort of idiot. So it was good to be able to see him portray the character having a little more like being necessary to the story instead of being kind of a hindrance to it.
Yeah, I loved that, and I love that he kind of uses it to play hardball with Mark a little bit. He's like, "Yeah, I'll help you translate this, but you gotta give me the body. I'm not doing it from here." that was kind of cool. God, I love Steven. I think he's great. I find him very endearing. Gosh, every time Steven does anything, I'm just, oh, he's so great. You go, Steven.
Yeah. Now, like I said, like now. It's not that I didn't like him necessarily. Well, I'm not gonna lie. I didn't really like him in the first episode, but like again, like now that he's actually moving the story forward instead of it kind of being stuck. I've enjoyed the character a lot more.
Yeah, that's a good point. I really like that they are. So let's see. Where's this episode open? Does it open on the rooftops? He's fighting people.
I'm sorry.
I'm trying to remember. I think it does. I'm just trying to remember where the episode opens. But pretty early on, they do the little hint at a third altar that he might have, which was fascinating. And you are the comic booky one over on your show, right?
Yeah, I am.
The most comic booky.
Yeah.
And so what kind of stuff do you know about Moon Knight from comics that you're hoping gets adapted here?
I really don't know that much. Like Moon Knight, I haven't really read much of his solo stuff. And so my familiarity with the character is like almost completely his guest appearances, where he's kind of like someone who's not really wanted. Like no one really wants him around because he's, weird and a little hyper violent, I guess. But like my understanding about the character is that he's one of those characters where it really, really depends on who's writing him, how he's characterized, and like even as far as like what he can do, and the multiple personalities kind of, helps with that, or maybe not necessarily helps with it, but makes that even more of a thing. So I don't really have much familiarity with the character, and this has been an interesting way to be introduced to him because, from what I understand, he's like really, really different
Interesting.
in his solo series. Like I know he's a billionaire and that's different, which thank God. I'm honestly so happy that he's not like a bit like that creative decision. And it's one that I know on your show a lot of times you talk about like the what do you call it? Like the multiverse effect, I think, where, when you're adapting a comic book character to a TV show, you can make them completely different and that's fine. And like sometimes those choices can just be so, because I would not like this character at all if he were a billionaire. I promise you, there's no way that I would relate to him at all. But with him being like a gift shop owner and just kind of a normal person, that allows for a little more relatability and a little more sympathy, at least for me.
Yeah, that's a good
So I
point.
was really happy with that change, at least. And I know some people weren't, which take it or leave it. Nothing's going to work for everybody, but
Yeah,
I
someone's
was
always going to be
happy with
unhappy.
that change. Yeah.
Let's see. So we in the episode, they oh my favorite Khonshu moment was he tells him to take the guy to the ledge, and the dude cuts off his own scarf and like falls. And Khonshu just goes, "Huh, I really thought he'd talk." And I
Yeah.
just thought that was very funny. They're making Khonshu terribly amusing, and I
Yeah,
like it.
I like this take on like first of all, visually, he looks really, really cool.
Oh, it's a cool look.
Yeah, so being able to see him, because I think in this third episode he was on screen a lot more than he was even in the second episode. And I really like that because the design of the character is just so cool. But like him being kind of a petulant mix between a baby and an old man, I love that. I love that choice for like a god character. That's great. Like we've seen wise old man with Odin. We've seen like the angry kind of himbo character with Thor. So let's get the like crotchety old man who is also a baby. I
Yeah,
love it.
it's such a fun characterization. I really like that they went that direction with him. I don't know what he's like in the comics either. I also don't even know if he's real in the comics. Apparently, that's different depending on which comic book you're reading.
Yeah.
I think it's
I
pretty
think
safe
there's.
to say that he's real here.
Yeah, I hope that he is.
Yeah.
I hope that it's not one of those, like, it was all a dream kind of stories, but
I
it does seem to
would be
not be.
shocked if they did, partly just because it's the MCU and I'm like, well, they're not gonna have it where no, he was just crazy. There was no Moon Knight. And then we just move on and we never hear from him again. I
Right.
doubt that would happen. But I would give them credit for the absolutely unpredictable twist if they did. I would have to give them credit for that.
Yeah,
Oh,
it would be
goodness.
weird for them to waste a 6-episode mini series doing that. But or is it, how many episodes is this
I
gonna be?
think it's going to be six. I'm pretty sure.
Okay. Well, it would be weird for them to waste that on a story that's not a story, but
Yeah.
it would be unexpected though.
I saw, just speaking of how it might connect to things, I saw a fan theory that at the end of the series, like Gore the God Butcher is gonna show up and kill Khonshu. I was like, I don't think they would do that, but that would be really cool.
It would make me pretty sad though.
It
I'm not gonna
would be
lie.
sad. I do like Khonshu. Although it's
Yeah.
hard to tell if you're meant to root for Khonshu. I guess by the end of this episode, he kind of sacrifices himself sort of to help Steven and Mark. So he seems okay. He's just kind of a dick. But
Yeah, he's like a crotchety old man. Like
yeah.
he can be doing good things, but then also you kind of like, you're like, nah, I wish you weren't around. Like, you don't want to deal with him, but you don't want him to die.
Yeah, he would
Like,
be very annoying to deal with.
yeah.
I love that he causes a solar eclipse just to get the Egyptian gods' attention so that they will all call a little meeting. I wonder if I'm guessing he didn't actually move the moon. Because I mean, granted, I'm just thinking about it too scientifically. If you move the moon abruptly and unexpectedly, you're gonna like flood something. And I assume that's not what happened. I assume it was kind of an illusion-ish, like what happened at the end. It's hard for me to tell if the sky stuff he did in this episode was an illusion or not, or if he was physically moving what's in the sky.
It seemed to me like he was physically moving it because I don't remember which one it was, but one of the gods told him, like, if you move the sky again, like,
Oh, yeah, that's a
you're
good
donezo.
point.
Like, we're gonna fuck up your shit, so don't do that again.
Yeah, I've seen
And then he
some
does it.
theories that he has like rewound the universe now and he's like put back like I don't remember what theory it was, but it was like he's rewound the universe. So that means that like Asgard is now intact again because he put the universe back 2,000 years to put all the stars back where they were. It's like, I don't think so. I don't think that's what happened. But I
Yeah.
don't know what happened if it wasn't just an illusion, so I have no idea. I don't know. This is beyond me.
Well, it might be why the gods were so mad at him about it, because, like, actually, so at first I was like, who cares? Like, why do they care so much if he, like, causes a solar eclipse? Like, who cares? But that actually makes sense about why they would care if, like, it's going to have. If he's actually moving, I didn't even think that, like, if you're moving celestial bodies, like, that's going to have a negative impact on a lot of people,
Yeah, it's gonna
a lot
mess
of
up
things.
everything.
Yeah, so maybe that's why they were so upset about it.
They could be.
But then it's also one of those things where, like, with the whole Asgard thing, I would doubt it, because that would be the. Just like, as I was watching it, it didn't seem like him rewinding the sky had much weight or ramifications outside of, like, this storyline. You
Yeah.
know what I mean? Like, that would be such a huge change to make on this show.
Yeah, I don't think they did that. And I also think that whatever it was went away when Khonshu went away, because Steven's like, I can't hold this, I can't keep it like this. And then the powers go away. So whatever he was doing got undone immediately.
I don't think it'll have
But it was
like
wacky.
permanent consequences.
I do love the thought of everyone in the MCU seeing that shit and just being like, yeah, okay. It's happening again. I just saw Arishem show up over London the other day. It's fine. They're just kind of done with all this shit. The MCU's gotten so weird that the people in it can't possibly care about seeing this.
They're just like, oh, okay. Well, I guess it's Tuesday.
Yeah, as long as
Someone.
I don't turn to dust again, I think I'm fine with whatever I'm looking at here.
And it was such a cool effect too. Like,
Oh, it was awesome.
that was probably one of my favorite scenes, was when he rewound the sky. I also really enjoyed the council scene where I think my favorite character moment for Khonshu this episode was when he was speaking through Mark, in the weird shoutiness and like
That was a great
Oscar
performance.
Isaac. Yeah, it was so like the physicality of it was so good, like the yelling, and then afterwards, he just looked so uncomfortable. It was pretty great. I really enjoyed that scene for the physicality, and then also just Mark admitting that like he's not well and he doesn't like this and he really does want it to stop.
Yeah,
Was
that
pretty
it's like
great. It was like,
I am not enjoying being an avatar.
yeah, it was a perfect mix of like humor and also seriousness and kind of weightiness. And I think it moved the character forward in a really fun and interesting way.
Also thought it was really interesting detail that I did not this didn't click for me until saw this mentioned somewhere on the internet that Harrow was like totally cool with Mark's dissociative identity disorder in the last episode. He was like, yeah, I feel for you. It must be very hard having all these different voices in one head and stuff. And then in this one, he uses it against him in the trial. He's like, no, this guy is crazy. He's got all these personalities. You can't trust what he's saying. And it was very sad to see that the one cool thing about Harrow was kind of a facade. He's actually not all that understanding of Mark's DID.
No,
I
he's
thought
the
that was pretty well
worst.
done.
How do you feel about him as a villain, like in general?
I think Ethan Hawke is playing this really well. He is very menacing, and he's perfectly nailed that I'm just an innocent, kind person vibe that you would get from a dangerous cult leader. And I'm really impressed with it. I like it quite a lot. I think he might be my favorite Disney Plus Marvel villain. I'm thinking through. Who have we got? We've got if you count He Who Remains, Jonathan Majors, if you count that, he's my favorite. But Ethan Hawke's Harrow would be a close second, I think. I like him a lot.
So this is another one where like my understanding of the character and my enjoyment of the character kind of changed from the first episode to this one. Like in the first episode, when they introduce him and he's putting glass in his feet and just being kind of a
Gruesome.
general weirdo, I was just like, okay. I didn't find him to be very compelling. Or like the scene in the museum where he's talking to Steven, not Mark, Steven. And he's just kind of going on. And there were a lot of times where I was just like, why doesn't he just kill this guy and take the scarab? Like, he has people who have guns. Why don't they just kill him and take the scarab instead of trying to like wrestle it out of his hand or whatever? But I think in the second episode, when you go into his compound and he actually has time to sit and talk with Steven, I think it was Steven at that time,
Yeah, I think it was.
one-on-one. That was that to me turned him into a much more compelling villain because, like you said, like the portrayal of that cult leader like demeanor was so good in the second episode and the third one. I think it was much better than in the first episode.
Yeah, Ethan Hawke is playing this so well. I'm impressed with everyone in this show right now. I'm impressed with Layla. I have forgotten the actress's name, but she is awesome. I like that she's I like that Steven, who I assume was kind of created. I don't know when Steven came into being. I don't know if this is meant to be one of those stories where he's always had DID and Steven's been around since childhood, or if that's been more recent. But it's interesting to me that Steven has some characteristics of Layla. In the French poem from last episode, and reading hieroglyphics and loving Egyptian Egyptology and stuff. That's very cool to me. I think that's a little nod to how much Mark cares about her. Assuming that Stephen, came around after he met Layla, which I think is probably the case. I don't know. I'm really scared of this show because I'm scared of what's going to happen if and when they reveal to Steven that he's like not been around long. And that's just going to really mess with me.
I really, first of all, I really like that we were introduced to Steven, who Steven is the actual alter. Like, he's not the baseline personality. And I really like that we saw things from his point of view first, because even though, I may not have much liked the first episode, and I may not have liked him very much in the first episode, but it was really important to have that kind of baseline because it makes what happens in the third episode where he's the one fighting for control, like it makes that so much more poignant. And then also it kind of helps you to sympathize a little with Mark, who may be a character that it's difficult to sympathize with just because, like, as Steven says over and over, like he hurts people, and he hurts a lot of people. So it may be difficult to really sympathize with that character. But when you see in the third episode during that council scene, like he's struggling so much and he's been trapped in his own head with Steven living out a life, it makes that character a lot more relatable is not necessarily the right word, but it a lot more sympathetic, I guess, which that's not even the right word. I don't really
I
know what
get
I'm
I
trying
get
to
what you're
say,
going for though,
but
and it's a great way to put it, because I'm noticing that a lot of people are having that problem. There's a lot of people who are saying, "Yeah, I loved Steven, but Mark is boring." I've seen that complaint so many times, and I'm like, "Okay, yeah." So had they opened with Mark, I don't think this would have landed for anyone. You need Steven for the show to work. I think. I don't think that Mark is boring, but I am noticing that that is a common complaint. Which I
neither do
guess.
I. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was gonna say, I guess it might be partly because of the contrast with Steven, but people are like, well, he's very interesting and very expressive, and Mark is much more serious and he's boring. I guess is where they're coming from. I don't really know.
Yeah, I could see that in the second episode. I don't understand that after the third episode.
Yeah, he's pretty
Because,
cool in the third one.
yeah, I mean, because Mark also was so like expressive, and you actually get like during the second episode, he was just kind of bland action hero, like give me the body, I'll beat up the bad guys, and then whatever. But in this third episode, you can see so much conflict within him and so much struggle within him. I don't think he's a bland or boring character at all.
Yeah, and this kind of tragedy of him dealing with being the avatar of Khonshu is interesting to me. It's and I don't know where I want it to go because I feel so bad for both of them now that I'm like, I don't want them to have to be beholden to Khonshu's wishes and demands, but I also love the concept of Moon Knight and want that to continue after the show.
Yeah, you can't have the superhero character without them being miserable, basically.
Oh, it's such a hard thing because I'm like, no, I just want them to be happy, but I really want Moon Knight.
Yeah.
I love
And
that Mr. Knight. No, go ahead.
I think I was actually going to bring up
Oh, yeah.
the third personality that's kind of emerging here. Like,
Who may or may not be Jake Lockley from the comics.
yeah, I think that kind of implies that being Khonshu's avatar is making his dissociative identity disorder worse,
Interesting.
and is making things worse for him. So it's like, it's even more so. Like, I want Mark to be well, and I want Steven to be well, but I also, there's no reason for them to be in the MCU anymore if they're well.
Yeah. That's a good point. Man, I hope we get to meet Jake. And I mean, I assume we will. They did the tease for a reason. But I don't know what his deal is. Is he just more violent than them? Is he kind of unhinged? I'm pretty excited to find out what's going on with Jake, assuming that it is Jake.
Yeah, whoever it is, it does seem like they're more violent.
Yeah, because if even Mark was surprised at how violent that was,
Yeah.
then Steven's like, I swear it wasn't me.
And he seems to emerge when there's a conflict between the other two character between the other two personalities, between Steven and Mark, about how much violence to use. Then this third character just kind of comes out and is like, okay, well, you guys don't get a choice anymore. We're killing everybody.
That's an interesting thought. That's a pretty fun idea. And I think you're right. I love that Mr. Knight did not turn out to be a one-off visual gag. I'm very happy it came back in this episode. I'm very happy with, I know that people are gonna do the whole the jokes are bad, actually. You're not supposed to like things with jokes, but and the MCU is bad. I know people are gonna do it again. But I love when Steven is like, all right, time out, everyone. Time out. Let's just all calm down. Let's chill the F out. And then he gets stabbed. He goes, Mark, take the body. Take the body. He just panics. That was great.
Yeah.
Oh,
And I
Steven's so
also
sweet.
think I understand the point of view of, like, you don't want to ruin your heavy emotional moments with jokes.
Yeah.
I understand that. Like, what is it called? I don't know what it's called. There's a word for it, but how, like, it needs to be used kind of intentionally. But I think that this show does that very well. Like that moment, for example, that wasn't a heavy emotional moment. It was, it was in a fight. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it didn't
Yeah.
detract from anything. It was just, and it was also
There.
something that was very comic booky, I thought. Like,
Yeah, very much so. There are only a couple of spots in the MCU where I disagree with the use of humor. And really, the only one I can think of off the top of my head is one joke from Thor Ragnarok. And it's just that they told a joke right after Asgard is destroyed. And that's really the only. And I feel like the film bro Twitter just kind of sees the entire MCU as that moment. I'm like, no, it's usually pretty cool. It's just I that one was a mistake, I think. But it's all great, in my opinion. You didn't need a joke when you blew up Asgard. But they usually don't put a big joke after something that's supposed to be sad or heavy emotional or intense. They just kind of sprinkle it in to keep the vibe going. And I like that.
yeah, like, quips and visual puns are something that are like, it's a part of comics. Like, it's something that's very important to the medium. So I think that kind of translates very well into the movies and the shows and stuff. So it doesn't really bother me. Now I can understand, because I probably am not as big of a fan of the MCU as you are, I would assume.
Probably.
But yeah. But I think that that's not the reason why. I think that jokes are fine and like lightheartedness is fine, as long as, like you said, it doesn't interfere with those big emotional moments. And I can't think of very many that were ruined by jokes in the MCU.
Yeah, the internet loves to collectively overreact. And it's fun to watch sometimes, but sometimes it's rather annoying. Let's
Yeah.
see, what else
Also,
was going on?
I just need to take a moment to acknowledge that the antiquities collector who they were fighting in that scene is very attractive. And I just need
Oh yes.
everyone to know that and to
The
recognize it.
Anton,
Yes.
I believe. And also, did you know that that actor has passed away?
Really?
It was so sad. He's it was like a skiing accident like 3 months ago.
Oh, that
Very
sucks.
recent. It was so sad. And I'm like, "Oh my God, that's it just it was, you know, it's terrible." Yeah, let me wait. I'm gonna try to find the name.
Gaspard Ulliel.
That was it. Yes. French actor. Yeah, died in what I'm pretty sure was a skiing accident like 2 or 3 months ago. It was so out of nowhere and very sad.
Yeah,
And he
that
was great in
sucks.
this. This was a great performance. I really like the actor. I'm very sad that that happened. Let me think. What else happened in this episode? It was very cool to
Oh,
see Moon Knight just wreck shop with all of those people.
yeah, it was a great scene. I think that was the first time that they actually needed Steven, I want to say, right, with the sarcophagus. So it was really interesting to see their kind of specialties playing against each other. And then, of course, Layla, like you said, Layla's awesome. Layla's a great character. And I like that she's able to be that like bridge between them. Steven and Mark are highly specialized in two very different ways. Like Steven knows a lot about Egyptology. He's great at like solving the puzzles and deciphering things. And then, Mark is a fight boy. He'll punch him up real good. And Layla can kind of do both to some extent.
Yeah, she's got that dagger necklace thing, which was awesome.
Yeah, that was very cool.
Oh gosh, she's so cool.
Yeah, the actress's name is Mae Kalamaui.
Okay, that's it.
Yeah.
Very cool.
And she's doing such a great job. Like I really like that she's, a lot of times when you have female characters who are portrayed as like the strong female character, like they're not allowed to have very vulnerable moments. But I really like that that Layla is able to have those like vulnerable moments where she's upset that she's upset that Mark, abandoned her, and she really loves him, and she's, has very strong feelings, and she's willing to be very vulnerable, but then at the same time, like, she's a very powerful character, which I like. And
Yeah, she gets to be very realistic.
and multidimensional. She's not just the Egypt expert, she's not just the antiquities thief or whatever. She gets to be a lot of different things, which I like.
Did you see, I don't know why, just thinking about the actors. Did you see the little promotional video before the show premiered of the Marvel Studios waiting room.
Did not.
It was a really funny, like 40-second video of just the three of them, Oscar Isaac and May and Ethan. They were all just in this like waiting room, and they're just talking about how they're upset that they can't leave the waiting room until the show premieres because spoilers aren't allowed. And so it's like Marvel Studios is holding them there against their will
Oh,
so
God.
that they can't accidentally spoil anything. And they're like playing the little paper football and like reading books and just finding ways to kill time. It was a very
Yes.
funny little video. I
That
quite liked that.
I never watched it, but that sounds pretty fun. Like that's a lighthearted version of it, but honestly, Marvel, Disney, you guys need to calm down with the secrecy. Like it's not that big of a deal. Like you can chill. Things are going to leak. Like it's just going to happen. It's inevitable and you know,
Yeah.
it's not going to ruin your movie. People are still going to see it.
Yeah, and I like that they did just do Doctor Strange that in the trailer for Doctor Strange 2, they're just like, "Yep, Patrick Stewart's in it. Don't worry about it. It's fine." The trailer. It's just like, yeah, there he is. We're not gonna bother hiding that one. We know you'll figure it out, so there you go. I think it's pretty cool.
I'm so intrigued. I haven't seen a Marvel movie in theaters in a while.
Ever?
Well, no, that's no, I in a while.
Okay.
I did see No Way Home in theaters.
Okay, good one to
I
pick.
did. Yeah, I did. I saw that in theaters, but before that, I can't even tell you which was the last one I saw in theaters. I maybe Ragnarok.
Wow, it's a ways back.
Yeah, I don't really like. I'm not like big on crowds and stuff, and I'm
Oh,
fine
okay.
watching it on like the small screen. But with No Way Home, it was like a whole event, and I, you know, I wanted to go see that in theaters, but also Multiverse of Madness. I'll probably see that in theaters as well, just
Yeah, because it's
because.
another one of those kind of big event moments. I live for the theater experience. I am obsessed with movie theaters. I love going. I love getting my popcorn, and I love sitting in a big crowd and watching a movie with a bunch of people who are excited to be there just like me.
Yeah,
That always makes me happy.
I've gone to what was it? I want to say, I think it was The Hobbit. I really like Lord of the Rings, so I think I did see The Hobbit, I believe, on opening night. And that was it's something that I think, you know, everyone should experience. It's not something I want to do again, but I'm glad that I did it once.
Yeah, I managed to catch pretty much every Marvel movie. Well, now I catch them on Friday nights, but I when I was in college, I would catch them on Thursday nights. The Thursday opening. That was nuts. Friday's just as good, really. I don't think I've ever waited to see a Marvel movie until the Saturday night. That's very rare that that happens to me. I gotta see them right when they come out. I think the only two
Actually,
exceptions
no.
to that. Oh, what were you saying?
I was gonna say, actually, I think I did see Endgame in theaters.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense because that's another one of those just epic big ones that you kind of gotta see. I think that seeing Endgame on the Thursday night it came out is to this day, I think, my single favorite theater going experience because I got to see it in a big theater with a big screen, lots of people. A bunch of people were there in costumes. I saw it in, I was seeing it in Austin, Texas, and there's a little cosplay group in Austin that call themselves the Austin Avengers, and they show up to like every premiere at this particular theater, dressed in all of their costumes, and I was in a costume as well, and it was just the coolest experience for an opening night. Also, because usually I either see a movie with my girlfriend or my parents. And on that night, I got to see it with my girlfriend, my roommate, and the co-host of the radio show that I was running at the time. And so it was pretty cool. It was a nice little group of people to see a movie with. So much reminiscence. Well, what was I
I'm
about to
glad you
say?
got that experience.
I was going to say something about theaters. Oh, yeah, there's only two. I think there's only two exceptions to Marvel movies that I see opening weekend in theaters, and that is Black Panther and the original Doctor Strange. It was because there was just shit going on in my life, and I didn't get to it until a couple weeks later. And
Yeah.
I was very sad about both of them that I couldn't see them opening weekend. But I will be seeing Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness on the Friday it comes out, so I am thrilled about that.
Yeah, I probably won't see it until a little bit after the debut, but I will probably see it in theaters.
Nice. We have a poll that I forgot to read last week. So here's a poll about episode one of Moon Knight. Sorry, guys. I wrote, who is Steven leaving those voice messages for? And the options were, it's Mark's mom and she's dead, or it's Mark's mom and she's alive, it's Steven's mom somehow, or a very confused random person who does not know why they keep getting these voice messages. And the vote came down to 67% for Mark's mom and she's dead, and 33% for Mark's mom and she's alive. So sounds like most of you think that the mom he is leaving messages for is no longer alive, which is what I'm thinking is probably the case. What do you think?
That's sad. I think at one point, doesn't Layla say something along the lines of like, so you're talking to your mom again or something like that?
Oh yeah, she does say, so you guys are talking again. I forgot about that line.
Yeah,
That
I think she's alive.
would hint that last she's aware, the mom is alive.
Yeah, but for me, what I would enjoy the most is if it's just a completely random person.
That would be so much fun if it
Yes.
turns out that it's just
I would
no
love
one.
that.
It's just some random number.
But I think it probably is, yeah, Mark's mom. And her being dead would be really sad to me.
Yeah, the only reason I think she's dead is because Layla has been out of the loop for several months, apparently.
Yeah.
And we never hear from the mom. We just see Steven leave her messages
Yeah.
that we don't see those messages returned. So I'm thinking that the mom may have passed away and Mark has, maybe it happened while he was Mark. So Steven is just unaware of this fact. I don't know. I have no
Yeah,
idea,
either
but
way, it's.
it's something that they're probably going to answer because they spent a substantial. They gave us two different scenes of it in the first episode.
Yeah, I would hope that they do address it. And either way, it's kind of sad. Like either
Yeah.
his mom is dead and he doesn't know it, or they're so estranged that she just completely ignores his voice messages, which is
Yeah,
also
that's
pretty
also
sad. But
true. I didn't think of that.
at least that would give some potential for like reconciliation, you
Yeah.
know?
I
Not that
hope.
it, I mean, I'm not super invested in that, but it would be nice to. It would just be another way to like make the character a little bit more healthy, like a little bit more well. Like it would be nice to see him get a win in that way.
Yeah. Oh God, Steven needs a win. I saw someone point out that the postcards that he was receiving from his mom, theoretically, look an awful lot like the postcards that he walks past when he goes into the museum gift shop, which would imply that Mark or Jake, I don't know, is sending these postcards to himself to kind of placate Steven and make him think his mom's still alive, but I don't know why they would do that. I don't know. The internet's a crazy place full of theories. That one sounds kind of plausible though, because they did make an effort to show us him walking past a giant rack of gift of a of a postcards.
Yeah.
I don't know.
No,
It's a
I
mystery.
believe it. I would believe it.
It's
It seems
definitely
like
something that
Mark
they
tries a
probably
lot to
intend
keep
to
him in
lay
the
out at some
dark.
point. I just based on the screen time they gave it, I assume they're gonna lay that out. I gotta think of a poll to put down for next week. What am I curious about? Jake? Maybe it can be if we're gonna see Jake in the next episode. I think that'll
Yeah.
be the poll.
It seems like so far they've done a really good job of introducing something mysterious and then not letting it linger for too long.
Yeah, that's a
So
good point.
I'm hoping that we'll see who this third personality actually is in the next episode. Not that, I mean, I think it'd be fine if it was like not until episode five. I don't think that would necessarily be too long, but they've done a really good job, I think, of striking that tone between like introducing something a little bit mysterious and shadowy and then explaining it before it kind of fades away in your mind, you know?
Yeah. So that's definitely going to be the poll, is do you, dear listener, believe that we are going to see the third alter in the next episode, like actually meet him in person and not just see the consequence of something that he may have done? I saw some theory that that was just Khonshu, that like it was that there is no third alter, it was just Khonshu took him over for a moment and murdered that dude. Maybe.
Yeah, maybe. But was Khonshu talking to him? Like, was Khonshu telling him to murder
No, it's a good. Yeah, he
what?
wasn't
Okay.
saying anything at that moment, so it feels
Yeah.
kind of unlikely.
I feel like it's a third personality. And I think that the third personality would also fit the best in the show, just 'cause it, like I said, I think it really shows that the relationship between Khonshu and Mark is not serving, like it's really harming him and making the things in his life worse.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Anyway, I guess we'll find out. Anything in particular that you're like super excited for in the coming episodes of the show? Anything you're hoping?
I think it's probably the third personality. I really want to know who that is.
Yeah, I
And
want
I'm
to meet Jake,
also, yeah,
if it's Jake.
and I'm curious to see what Mark slash Steven, like who they become without Khonshu, like without Khonshu's voice in their head, because
Yeah.
what's Harrow, you know, when Harrow was no longer Khonshu's avatar, either by choice or maybe something happened that severed their relationship, who they haven't revealed that yet. That's, I guess that's something that I would like to know. I would like to know with a little bit more specificity also what happened between Harrow and Khonshu to make them hate each other so much. But, you know, when Khonshu was out of Harrow's head, it seems like he just continued down the path of like mental unwellness until he got to where he is now. So I would like to see what happens with Mark and Steven once that voice is out of their head, how they, you know, reconcile with that and how they move forward from that. And I hope the show does give us a little bit of time with them without Khonshu.
Yeah, I hope
Hope
so.
it's not something that's resolved right away.
That would be very interesting to get to see that play out. Yeah, that's probably what I'm most hoping for now. Now that you say it, that's all I've got to say about this episode of Moon Knight. You got anything else?
I don't know. There's so many things that happened that it's just like it was a little bit this episode was a bit more like exciting and action-packed, but then that also like there were definitely scenes that stuck out a lot to me, like the council scene. I guess that's something else that I want to see is the other avatars, like how they're going to behave, because I'm assuming that Harrow is going to be successful in releasing I can't even think of the goddess's name that he's trying to release.
Emmett.
Yeah, I'm assuming that he's going to be successful in that, and I wonder what the other avatars are going to, are they going to know about it right away? Are they going to come help? Like, what are
Yeah,
we?
that's interesting.
I don't know if I want that to happen or if I don't, like if I want the other avatars to come and help or not. But I am curious to see whether it's going to happen.
You cut to Ant-Man saying, "I think our first move should be calling the Avengers."
Yeah.
Lord. All right, that's all I got. Monte, where can the good people find you?
Like we said, I'm part of the SJW Comic Book Club. We have a Twitter, which is SJW Comics Cast. You can always hit us up on there. My co-host Veronica is usually the one that will answer. But I mean, we'll all see it, I guess. You can also email us at SJW Comics Podcast at gmail.com. And then you can find us on any, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, anywhere.
Awesome.
Oh, wait,
You
we have an
what?
Instagram that I'm totally blanking on the name of. But Melissa will kill me if I don't man it, if I don't mention it.
You can do
Just
it.
a minute.
I believe in you.
Maybe.
Yeah, lining up all the plugs is hard.
Yeah.
We were gonna launch a Discord, but I don't think enough people listen to this show to warrant launching a Discord.
Yeah, that's so like we have a Discord that we use with like another show that we've collaborated with. But yeah, I don't think we get enough like interaction to warrant a Discord. Oh, it's and it's the same. Sorry, I said that I said I was gonna plug the Instagram, and then I pulled it up and I didn't even like mention it. But it's the same. It's SJW Comics Cast
Awesome.
on Instagram too.
You can find us at Fandom Optimists on Twitter. That whole account is nothing but good vibes and Twitter polls. I will post the poll that I mentioned earlier up there sometime today or tomorrow or the next day. Who knows? You can vote on it by following us. You can also leave comments under our polls and we will read those comments on the show. That's a quick way to send us some mail. Yeah, that's all I've got. Until next time, guys, never apologize for loving your fandom and try to stay optimistic. I'll talk to you next week.